بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. So I want to speak a little bit more about this issue of the prayer carrying a child. Some further questions have been posed to me, so I should certainly address them. As I mentioned in the previous video, that any person teaching the deen should be open to scrutiny of what he teaches and should be willing to respond, as long as the response is beneficial. And I feel up till now there is still benefit in continuing this conversation and responding, because some things I think need slightly more clarification. Some questions have been raised. I'll answer them inshallah. Prior to that, I want to address some general issues or concerns that have been raised regarding this entire discussion. First and foremost, some people have said the laity, the lay people, are getting confused in this entire discussion. And I can appreciate that, because this is quite a technical discussion. And my advice to such people is, this entire question was answered, I think it's roughly a week ago, on my website with reference to hadith and authentic Hanafi sources. We'll include a link in the description, inshallah. You can go back to that. There it's presented in a very straightforward an easy way, with a direct connection to the Mubarak hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So anybody who wants the answer without going into any further details, bismillah, just access that. Just to mention a couple of other points related to this, sometimes when people speak about the lay person, it's spoken about as if it's perfectly fine and acceptable for a good number of this ummah, a good proportion of this ummah, to have little or no knowledge of the Islamic sciences. It's not always the case, but sometimes it is, and I want to address it, inshallah. It should not be the case that there's a vast portion of this ummah that essentially has no knowledge of the deen. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam obliged all of us to study the deen. طَلَبُ الْعِلْمِ فَرِيضَةٌ عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ, as is narrated in a sound hadith according to Imam Suyuti, Imam Mizzi and others, although there's some difference of opinion regarding its authenticity. Once again, we'll have a link to this inshallah, for people to be able to understand the whole concept of obligatory knowledge. So it is important when somebody says, oh, I haven't studied anything, I'm confused. Yes, try to alleviate this person's confusion, of course, but also advise the person that this is not an acceptable position to be in. You must study the deen. So that's the recourse for the lay person, or any person who feels that this is getting too technical for them and it's too difficult for them to understand. No problem, inshallah. There's a clearly accessible, easy to understand answer regarding this issue. But that doesn't mean people who, you know, mashallah, have more learning, more of a background in Islamic studies, especially the Hanafi madhab, and want to learn and want some of the issues to be resolved and want to understand some of the technicalities of the madhab and, you know, how to understand the madhab correctly, we shouldn't deprive such people. We should provide for everybody, inshallah ta'ala. Something's been provided for those people who have, you know, less of an understanding or getting confused. No problem. You don't need to continue on these discussions, inshallah. Just go to that and that will take care of your needs, inshallah ta'ala. As for those who would like to understand more, let's not deprive them. Let's continue our discussion to its conclusion, inshallah ta'ala. Secondly, something that's been raised, and I want to address also by way of introduction, really, before I get into the actual questions that were raised or issues that have been raised since my previous video. First of all, some people look at this and say, oh, this is all a fitna. It's all, you know, it's just causing problems and it's just causing corruption in the ummah and discord in the ummah. And, you know, the brother, if he had an issue with my article, he should have contacted me directly and privately and just had a conversation with me, and there was no need to make it so public. I'm going to generally disagree with this point. I'll agree with an aspect of it. Sometimes it can be useful to have an initial discussion in private. But just if we play this out for a moment, had the brother spoken to me personally or to Sheikh Aslam, who made the original video, personally, and you know, we had differing views and understandings and opinions, which it clearly seems that we have, then he would have to, if he believes that there's an error here and it's out in public, he would have to still announce it in public and speak about it in public, and he feels he needs to warn people about it, and he would have to do that publicly. Now, I feel he's mistaken, and there is room here, and as I said in, you know, one of my first answers, that there's no need to be categorical here. There is room here. I feel he's mistaken, but, you know, he is convinced that this prayer is invalid, and he is well within his rights. And not just within his rights, this is something a person should do. The slight concern here is that he's done it in a situation where he is mistaken. But khair, that's his view, that's his opinion. But we need to stop calling just absolutely any kind of discussion regarding the deen, if the discussion is public, fitna, and this is a fitna and it's a problem. It's not a problem. People can learn from it, inshallah ta'ala. And as I said, those who do feel confused or what have you, no problem, they have recourse. It's been presented to them. If no clear answer was given and there was just this heavy, detailed, technical discussion, then yes, I would agree. But we need to be able to, as an ummah, and especially religious educators, we need to be able to express our concerns when we have concerns regarding certain things that are being taught, but without being accused of fitna all of the time. Again, I will agree that had this been a more confusing issue, an issue that can, you know, really misguide people with regards to understanding the fundamentals of Islam, then yes, those kind of things are best not discussed in great detail in public, like certain issues regarding aqidah. Detailed discussions and differences of opinion regarding aqidah, to have those in public, in such a public way, I may agree with people that, hold on, that's a bit of a concern. Maybe we need to be a bit more careful regarding it. It doesn't mean we should never address issues of aqidah in public, especially when you feel people are being misguided. But, you know, the intricate, really intricate matters that are already understood by the ulama to be issues that confusion can occur regarding, we need to be a little bit more careful there, inshallah ta'ala. Not all issues of aqidah, and it shouldn't be considered, you know, just out of bounds. It may be suitable and appropriate at times. And building on this issue of not feeling that this is fitna and the whole thing is just problematic and it's, you know, it's there's no benefit in it, I believe there's great benefit in it, inshallah ta'ala. A lot of people, especially people who are a little bit more advanced in their studies, can benefit a great deal. And so building on that, I also want to comment on, generally speaking, I believe from the teachers involved in this discussion, by and large, there has been adab observed, decorum, alhamdulillah. And it should show us that, look, as Muslims, we can differ regarding issues without resorting to name calling. Now, obviously, I don't know the full ins and outs of this. Maybe there was some of that. I don't know. But I'm speaking about what I have seen. And from the point I've been involved in this discussion, I've seen adab, alhamdulillah. Yeah, disagreement, no problem. But we can disagree with each other and still respect each other and still want good for each other. What I would say, though, it seems in terms of not the teachers themselves, but the students, if you like, or the followers of these some teachers, or maybe all teachers, sometimes the adab is not upheld. Look, in the context of deen, we should always observe adab and akhlaq. This is what our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us. Okay, so I'm addressing more so the students, if you like, or followers of particular sheikhs, that when you discuss these issues, and it might be in comment sections or it might be on various platforms, social media platforms, it's fine, inshallah ta'ala. Obviously, be aware, don't speak about things that you don't have knowledge of, but feel free to discuss, but do it with adab. Do it respectfully, okay? Let's not be childish about things. Let's not, you know, insult each other, use inappropriate nicknames and belittling titles and such things. But let's speak respectfully. We're all brothers, alhamdulillah. Okay, we can disagree, no problem, but we need to maintain adab. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had a huge focus on akhlaq, on character, and we must maintain that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all tawfiq. So I will call on Brother Shahid also to, I'm sure he's done so, and as a reminder, to call upon all those involved in these discussions to maintain adab. I'm not saying this is one-sided. Whoever's involved in name-calling and speaking in a belittling, condescending manner, insulting people, this is something that we as an ummah should be above. In that light, I also want to speak about the approach we should have regarding these kind of matters. And once again, no doubt the teachers too, but this very much includes the students, followers, etc. We must bear in mind that our deen is too important, too precious to us, that level of importance and the precious nature of it should prevent us absolutely from treating religious discussion like a spectator sport. You have your team, you're with them, you cheer them on, whether they're good or bad, defend them whether they're good or bad. Let's not do this. Okay, look, fine, you've studied with a particular individual and inshallah you've benefited from this person, but accept and acknowledge that this person can be mistaken at times, whoever it is. And don't just argue the points of this person irrespective of the situation, the context, and what you truly believe with regards to the accuracy. Give yourself time and space and think about what you believe is correct. Now, quite often your teacher will be correct. Quite often the person who's opposing your teacher will be correct. Be open to it. Deen is too important to just divide ourselves into groups and follow particular individuals, and then based on that, whatever that group or that individual says, that's it, we're with it. And in this light, it's important to bring up the issue of being sectarian about things. Okay, just labeling people, oh, he's from this sect, he's from this group, we're from this group, we're not going to accept what he's saying, who does he think he is, we're against them. This is not how the deen works. We are all Ahl Sunnah, or should be anyway. And as long as we are following the methodology of Ahl Sunnah, we must be open-minded to it. And the methodology of Ahl Sunnah is our proofs, our Quran and Hadith, and those proofs related to it. And Quran and Hadith, we believe, often requires understanding and interpretation. And the understanding and interpretation should come from authoritative, classical scholars. So whoever's doing this, whoever's providing Quran and Hadith, providing authoritative classical scholars, it's absolutely unacceptable, sectarian, tribal, and I would say, unfortunately, somewhat childish as well, just to rubbish that as, oh, that person belongs to such and such a group, such and such a group. Okay. Personally, I label myself as nothing other than Muslim, and then I will identify as Ahl Sunnah. In the context of fiqh, I will tell people I am a follower of the Hanafi madhab. Okay? We need to be careful of really dividing up into smaller and smaller groups and opposing each other on this basis. We have a methodology in Ahl Sunnah. Let's follow that. And unfortunately, all too often, the approach of name-calling and labeling and discarding people, not based on evidence, not based on the references provided, but based on a label you can throw at that person, which is quite often wrong anyway, this is the recourse of somebody who wants to either avoid the discussion or has no evidences to present. Okay, this is not the way of people of knowledge, and shouldn't be the way of the ummah, of the Muslims. Rather, we're not interested in labeling people. You're this, I'm this, I'm that. We're not interested in that. As long as the methodology of Ahl Sunnah has been presented, it's fine. I don't personally label myself, as I've mentioned, as Bareilvi or Deobandi. Okay, I am from the Ahlus Sunnah. I follow the mainstream, inshallah ta'ala. But if somebody who does label himself as Bareilvi or Deobandi, that's up to him, okay, presents me an argument or a position or opposes me, and he's using Quran, he's using Hadith, okay, he's using authentic sources, I'm going to listen to that. I'm not going to discard it as, well, he's that, or he's this. I'm going to listen to it, and I will respond to him, inshallah ta'ala, as long as I feel it's beneficial and useful, and time permits, inshallah. I can't respond to every single person who ever wants to discuss or debate or argue. I apologize for that somewhat lengthy introduction, but I feel very strongly about these points, and since it seems quite a lot of people are following this discussion, then I felt this is a good platform for it. If I now move on to some of the issues and questions raised, first and foremost, in two videos now, if I'm not mistaken, or the two I've seen, the brother has quoted from the Mubsut of Imam al-Sirakhsi, rahimahullah ta'ala. And there's a point he's made, which I'm going to go into in another video, inshallah ta'ala, which is not directly related to the question he asked. But both times he's given the impression that Mubsut Sirakhsi is such a book that we rely on it almost exclusively. This is obviously not the case, and I would just ask him to clarify. I'm sure he doesn't believe that, and just clarify it, please, because there are a lot of tulab al-ilm, you know, students of the Islamic sciences observing and watching, and we don't want them to get the wrong idea. We don't have any book in the Hanafi madhhab which is exclusively relied upon. Now, even what you tend to find, especially amongst scholars, Hanafi scholars from the Arab world, and I'm sure with many in the subcontinent as well, a heavy reliance on Radd al-Muhtar Ibn Abidin's Hashiya, there is a heavy reliance on that. Even then, it's not right to say there's an absolute reliance upon it, but the very reason scholars look to the Hashiya of Ibn Abidin is because he gathered, or he done such a good job at gathering the various opinions from authoritative Hanafi scholars, books and sources. And that should really make it quite clear to any student of the Hanafi madhhab, is it's not the case that we rely on one scholar exclusively and what he says exclusively. There's no doubt that the Mabsut of Imam al-Sirakhsi has an important position within the madhab, and Ibn Abidin rahimahullah ta'ala quotes it a lot in his Hashiya. Okay, but it's not the case that when Ibn Abidin discusses an issue and he quotes the Mabsut of Imam Sirakhsi, he will not quote any other book because he feels that that's it. Mabsut Sirakhsi has been mentioned, we don't need anything else. No, of course, Mabsut Sirakhsi is important, but there are many, many important texts in the Hanafi madhab, and they all need to be consulted. And sometimes, because people do kind of hone in and fixate on particular texts, and I'm not accusing the brother in the video of doing any of this, I just want to clarify, hone in on specific texts, they can actually go wrong and they can make significant errors. And as I said, that's one of the reasons that Hanafi scholars return to the Hashiya of Ibn Abidin, rahimahullah ta'ala, again and again and again, because he protects you from that somewhat. Okay, you still can't rely on the Hashiya on its own, but he protects you from that somewhat, because he will, with great regularity, mention a lot of opinion from a lot of books, and alhamdulillah, also with great accuracy, he will do it. Everybody makes mistakes and errors, but these are the main reasons. So not only did I want to clarify that, but this is actually now going to feed into the first issue I want to discuss or respond to. The brother has quoted from the Mabsut of Imam al-Sirakhsi on two occasions at least. I did want to address this last time, but the video was already quite long, and I just quickly just picked up on the comment of the Jordanian scholar and thought that might be sufficient for now. But anyway, when I first saw this in the Mabsut of Imam Sirakhsi some time ago, you know, it did jump out at me. Okay, what jumped out at me is specifically the word O here. And then Brother Shahid quoted this, and, you know, it jumped out again. Why does it say O? just briefly quote and translate it again. فَإِنَّ الْمَرْأَةَ إِذَا حَمَلَتْ صَبِيَّهَا أَوْ أَرْضَعَتْهُ لَمْ يُشْكِلْ عَلَى أَحَدٍ أَنَّهَا فِي غَيْرِ الصَّلَاةِ. By the way, this is a typo as sometimes you find in certain copies. It should be يُشْكِلْ, not يَشْكُلْ. Which translates as, for indeed, if a woman carries her child, or, and focus on this please, in Arabic it's O, in English, or breastfeeds him, it would not be difficult for anyone to conclude that she is not in Salah. Why did this jump out at me? Because if you read it as it is, it looks like Imam al-Saraqsi is saying that simply carrying a child in Salah invalidates the prayer. Now, up till now, I'm not sure of the position taken by Brother Shahid. I'm not sure if he's trying to say in his videos that whenever you carry a child, your prayer is invalid, or his issue is that Sheikh Aslam, when he put the child down and he picked him up, he done it with two hands. What is the issue he has? Because at some points, he seems to be discussing the fact that picking up the child and putting him down with two hands, or whenever you use two hands, that's a problem. That is the issue. And at other points, he seems to be quoting, be it from the Mabsut of Imam Saraqsi or the Jordanian scholar, an absolute invalidation of Salah whenever you carry a child. So it's got nothing to do with how you carry or put the child down or pick the child up. It's just whenever you carry a child, your prayer is invalid.
That when the onlooker is looking at somebody, and when he is looking at that person, the onlooker is left in no doubt that this person is not praying Salah. If this happens, then that action of that person is classed as Amal Kathir, a major action, and that person is classed as not praying. The Salah would be invalid. So this is the first qawl, the first opinion. A second position mentioned in the fatawa of Imam Ibn Abidin and in other Hanafi books is the two-hand rule. So if you use two hands to do something in Salah, for example like this, then your Salah is broken. This is Amal Kathir. Sheikh Lu'ay of Jordan and Mufti Qasim of Yemen. Now these are great Hanafi scholars from the Arab world, and they saw this video and they also said the Salah is invalid.
القاعدة عندنا ما لا يشك الناظر لفاعله أنه ليس في الصلاة وهذا من رآه ورآه أنه لا يصلي وإن كان النقل صحيح الحديث.
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. حياكم الله. أهلا ومرحبا يا أخي. هذه الصلاة بهذه الكيفية مبطلة. لماذا؟ لأن هذا الحديث الذي ورد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه كان يصلي ويحمل أمامة هذا في بداية الإسلام، وهذا الحديث منسوخ بأحاديث كثيرة، منها الحديث كثرة يعني العبث في الصلاة وكثرة الحركة في الصلاة، فهذا الحديث منسوخ ولا يصح حمل الطفل في الصلاة. بارك الله فيك.
So then he says, so if a woman carries her child or feeds her child, then it is not difficult upon anyone to see that she is not in Salah. So subhanAllah, this is a decisive statement. Picking up the child, putting down the child. At that moment, if an onlooker was to look, and remember the onlooker does not know whether this person has started Salah. If an onlooker was to observe this action, he would know that this person is definitely not in Salah. The hadith is from the Khasa'is, from the specialities of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that this action was specific to him. Some scholars explained it ala sabilil majaz, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wasn't picking up and putting down Sayyida Umama himself, rather she was clinging on to him and getting off herself.
To this point, I'm not sure what position Brother Shahid has taken. It would be good for him to clarify this. And if he does take the position that no, it's fine to carry a child, it's just the video that was shown regarding it, the video of Sheikh Aslam, that it was done incorrectly, then if that's his position, I would advise him just to produce a video. Allah Most High bless him, you know, he produces good high quality videos. Just produce a video praying with a child, showing us how it should have been done in his view and his opinion. Okay, that will clarify the issue for everybody, inshallah ta'ala, for those who are, you know, agreeing with him and following him, and those who are against him. It will be clear for everybody exactly what he means and exactly what he's saying. And if his point is, no, there's no way you can carry a child and have a valid prayer, then that would be good to clarify also. So anyway, if I come back to the issue of what's mentioned in the book of Imam Sarakhsi, why did it jump out at me? Because it said oh instead of wa, okay? It says or instead of and. And this makes a huge difference, because if Imam Sarakhsi has said that carrying a child and breastfeeding the child invalidates a prayer, then that's absolutely in line with what the major scholars of the madhab have said. Whereas if he said just simply carrying a child or breastfeeding, meaning just simply carrying a child invalidates the prayer, then this goes against the position of the madhab. And that's something that needs to be looked into thoroughly. And that's precisely why it jumped out at me. And here I will pause and remind Brother Shahid that in the first video he made regarding my article, he spent a good amount of time saying, you know, you should be following the Mu'tamad, you should be teaching the Mu'tamad, promoting the Mu'tamad. He spent a lot of time, rightly so, because he's right, you should. The problem was, there was a misrepresentation of what I'd actually said. And he does seem to have moved away from that now. It would be good, you know, just for the sake of clarity, it would be good if he just said that, okay, fine, I acknowledge he wasn't saying that, but let's speak about what he is saying, and I still disagree with what he is saying. Just for the sake of clarity, it's good to, you know, just when we're in agreement regarding an issue that we previously disagreed on, it's good to acknowledge for everybody, inshallah. Anyway, so why is this being quoted just like that, when it's clearly not the mu'tamad, not the relied upon opinion in the madhab? The relied upon opinion, clearly no doubt about it, is the opinion of the majority that prayer is valid when you pray carrying a child. And if you do it without a need, it's makruh. This was mentioned in the first answer I wrote on the website. And as I said, this is why it jumped out at me. I would be very, very surprised if Imam al-Sarakhsi had gone against the Mu'tamad. And as it's clarified in the very same book, the Mabsut of Imam al-Sarakhsi, that this is absolutely not his position. Elsewhere in the Mabsut, he mentions his position very, very clearly. قال وإذا صلت المرأة وهي حاملة ابنتها أجزأها لما روي أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يصلي في بيته وأمامة بنت أبي العاص يحملها على عاتقه فكان إذا سجد وضعها وإذا قام رفعها قال وهي مسيئة في ذلك لأنها شغلت نفسها بما ليس من أعمال صلاتها. So if I translate that, he said, if a woman prays whilst carrying her daughter, it is valid, meaning the prayer is valid, because of what was narrated, that the Prophet ﷺ used to pray in his home, and Umama, the daughter of Abu al-As, he would carry her on his shoulder. And when he, ﷺ Muhammad, would prostrate, he would put her down. And when he would stand, he would lift her up. He said, and she will be mistaken in doing so, meaning in carrying her child whilst praying, because she has busied herself with something which is not from the actions of Salah. Imam Sarakhsi is completely in line, as it's explicitly mentioned here, is completely in line with the madhab on this issue. He mentions very clearly that if a woman prays Salah carrying her child, ajza'aha, the prayer is valid. So this leads to the question of why is there an O there? What's going on with the other text? And I did have a look around, and this is important to do because sometimes there are typing errors, etc. I looked at a number of different publications, and I did find all of them had O. So once again, you know, the principle I mentioned at the beginning, and we should stick to our principles unless we are convinced they are wrong. The principle I mentioned at the beginning, when something is clear in the Nusus, it's clear. But when there's a huge amount of ambiguity caused, then we should go to contemporary scholars. So I went to a number of my own teachers and asked them with regards to this, what do they think about the O here? And they responded to me saying that There's an error here. We're not sure when it's occurred. You know, is it in the publication? Is it from the person who was handwriting this from the books of Imam Sarafsi, or as Imam Sarafsi dictated? We're not sure where it occurred, but this is clearly an error. And it's clear that Imam Sarafsi's position is the same as the scholars of the madhab, or the majority of the scholars of the madhab, and the sound opinion of the madhab, that there's no automatic invalidation of the salah when a person prays carrying a child. So hopefully this is clear now, that Imam Sarakhsi doesn't have a position where it's absolutely invalid to pray salah carrying a child. That is clearly not his position. He's made his position clear elsewhere in his book. He's even quoted the Mubarak hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or referred to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So I think that was very important for people to know the actual position of Imam Sarakhsi. And this position, almost the exact same wording, is mentioned in other books. And in other books, we do have it with a waw. For example, Bada'i', Imam Kasani rahimahullah ta'ala, he has it with a waw. So Imam Al-Kasani says, أو حملت امرأة صبيها وأرضعته لوجود حد العمل الكثير على العبارتين. فأما حمل الصبي بدون الإرضاع فلا يوجب فصال الصلاة لما روي أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يصلي في بيته وقد حمل أمامة بنت أبي العاص. Which translates as, or if a woman carries her child and breastfeeds him, because excessive movement exists here according to both opinions. As for carrying a child without breastfeeding, it does not necessitate the invalidation of the salah because of what has been narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to pray in his house carrying Umama, daughter of Abu al-As radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma. You have something similar from Al-Muhit Al-Burhani, almost the same words, but we have a waw instead. And something very similar from Imam Al-Aini. So again, when something is clear in the books of the classical scholars, then we don't need to go to contemporary ulama and ask them exactly what this means. But when there is an issue, there is a problem, and there's a clear issue here, why does it say, oh? Then we should go to them, and we should even more so look in other books and read around. And sometimes this focus on just one text, one authoritative text, I'm not speaking about, you know, mixing between classical books and later books that are not accepted by the entirety of the Hanafi scholars. Okay, I'm not speaking about books that are either very recent by scholars who are little known, relatively speaking, or books are fairly recent written by scholars who are accepted by a group of Hanafi scholars, but not all Hanafi scholars. I'm speaking about books that are accepted by all Hanafi scholars. Such books, when you find something clear and explicit and nothing contradicting it, then fine. Had Imam Sarakhsi not said, had he not said elsewhere in his book that a woman praying salah carrying a child is valid, then we would have to accept that it seems Imam Sarakhsi has an issue with this, because he did say, oh. Now, obviously, what would be most correct in that circumstance is to go back to the original manuscripts and see what's there. And this is what scholars tend to do when there's an issue like this. The point here is he's clarified it himself elsewhere in the book. So even if we do find it like this in all copies and all manuscripts, we'll simply have to say this is sab'ul qalam. This is, you know, an error, a slip of the pen, as they say. Now, his position is clear. So that leads once again to the issue of quoting the Jordanian scholar. Brother Shahid, in his most recent video, said, look, he's just mentioned a position, which is a position within the madhab, and, you know, it's fine to quote him, that the hadith is mansukh. It's fine to quote a position, and when it's not the sound opinion in the madhab, to highlight it's not the sound opinion in the madhab. This response did surprise me because of the, well, it surprises me anyway, because when you quote something which is not the opinion of the madhab, not the soundest opinion in the madhab, you should mention it for the sake of transparency. Of course you should, okay? But It's even more surprising because the original video, as I said, that was put out against the article, there was a good amount of time devoted to insisting upon mentioning the strongest opinion. So now this for me is concerning, troubling, confusing. What's going on here? On the one hand, there's an insistence, which is correct, and at the time I said it's correct, an insistence on presenting the sound opinion on the madhab and not moving away. But now, something very different is happening. An opinion in the madhab is just being mentioned without clarifying that this is not the position of the madhab. At least initially that wasn't done. And as I said, Brother Shahid really should clarify exactly what he's saying. Is he saying that whenever you carry a child, it's invalid? Or when you carry a child, put him down with two hands, pick him up with two hands, that's what causes the prayer to be invalid? I'm already way over time. I didn't intend for this video to be so long. So there are other things I wanted to speak about, especially something I consider to be self-evident, the fact that the whole issue of the onlooker deeming your prayer to be valid or invalid is subjective. I believe that to be self-evident, but it's not. So inshallah, I will speak about that in a subsequent video. Now I just finally want to touch upon the issue raised regarding Rafa Yadain. This will be brief because we're in agreement. Just prior to that, there was an error in what Brother Shahid said. Now this may simply be a slip of the tongue, or it could be an error in understanding. No problem, inshallah ta'ala. The purpose of this is not to score cheap points or to make the person I'm disagreeing with look like, you know, he has no knowledge, he has no right to be speaking about it. These are extreme positions people take, and these are, I'm sorry, I'm going to say, cheap tactics that people use when disagreeing with each other. Oh, you got this one thing wrong. Oh, that means he's not worthy to speak. This is incorrect. But the point is, he, when referring to Al-Kafi, which when he spoke about Al-Mabsut, he referred to Al-Kafi. And he said, this is the book of Sadr al-Shaheed. This is the book of Al-Hakim al-Shaheed. There's a significant time gap between the two. So that would just be good when he gets a chance to clarify that for the people. Obviously, this is for advanced level students, but or more advanced level students, but it will be good for them to know, inshallah ta'ala. Anyway, the issue of Rafa' al-Yadain now. So the entire reason I mentioned the Rafa' Yadain Mas'ala, and it's referenced in the previous video, is simply to show that there's not an absolute correlation between two hands, the opinion of using two hands invalidating your prayer, and the opinion of the onlooker deeming you not to be praying invalidating your prayer. That was the only purpose for it. So to try to make it clearer once again for everybody listening, as Ibn Abidin said, you have at least five opinions, and no doubt they are different opinions with regards to excessive movement. We're focusing right now on two of them. The first and the strongest one, if an onlooker would deem you not to be praying, then your prayer is invalid. This is the strongest opinion, and this is what I've said is somewhat obscure and somewhat open to interpretation, and I will explain that even further in an upcoming video. That is the strongest opinion. The opinion of whenever a person uses two hands, the prayer is invalidated is a different opinion. And what I felt was being done in an earlier video is there was, there seemed to be some attempt to make the two one and the same, the two opinions one and the same. And there was something quoted regarding that from the books by the brother. So I just wanted to make it crystal clear that although there is some overlap, as he said in his video, it's not an absolute rule. It's not the case that these two opinions are essentially one, that whenever a person uses two hands, he is involved in excessive movement, because an onlooker would always think that you are not praying Salah. That was the reason for mentioning the Rafa' Yadain Mas'ala, to show that there is not an absolute correlation. You can have a situation in which you are doing something with two hands and an onlooker will see it and will think you are in Salah. And I believe on this point, we are now, based on what I saw in his recent video, we are now in agreement. So we both agree that the reason your prayer is not invalidated when you perform rafa' yadain in the salah is because an onlooker would not think you are outside of salah. Therefore, it is incorrect to say whenever you do something with two hands, an onlooker will think you are not praying. That was the only purpose for that, and that has now been fulfilled because alhamdulillah we are in agreement that these are two separate opinions and not one and the same. And it is not correct to say it's an absolute rule. Whenever you use two hands for something, your prayer is invalidated. That is not an absolute rule. The absolute rule is whenever an onlooker would think you are not praying salah, your prayer is invalidated, which is subjective. That is the absolute rule we have. So it may be the case that a person is using two hands for something and an onlooker thinks he is praying. And it may be the case that an onlooker sees a person doing something with two hands and thinks he is not praying. Both are possible. I hope this is of benefit. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all and grant us all tawfiq and accept from all of us, inshallah ta'ala. I will be producing at least one more video on this issue. I realize, as I mentioned at the beginning, that this may no longer be of interest to many of the listeners because it's a level above their studies, which is fine. But those people who are benefiting and listening, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from them and grant us all tawfiq and acceptance. If there are still questions after the next video, once again, I am willing to address them as long as there is benefit, inshallah ta'ala. If the whole issue descends to just pure repetition and misunderstanding, then I don't think it will be beneficial any longer, inshallah. But as long as this is beneficial, I am willing to help to the best of my ability. Barakallahu feekum.